Dead, I don't know whether to call you dead or to just call Muruti Habile. For this morning, allow me to call you Muruti. I greet you with Mama Tsidi in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Greetings to all you saints, all the structures in the church, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Ntate Habile, let me appreciate the opportunity that was given to us over this weekend to come and minister at MCC. When we initially got the invitation, Loretta and I were saying, what is happening? I mean, it's you know that time and again when you are called by dad, the Lord would have dropped something into his heart. And he's calling you to say, the Lord says, and what's happening in your life? And when we got this call, it was more like one of those calls. And we just thought, you know what? There was no way that we could say no, because we knew that it was God appointed time for us to come to Maritzburg. Amen. Dad, the Lord is still good. The Lord is still sustaining us. The Lord is still keeping us. We are in Mhluzi. As you have said, and God is showing us great things in Mhluzi. Mhluzi is never the same. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I remember in the past, just to share with the saints, there was a time when we were going through a rough patch, Loretta and I, in our lives and in our marriage. And the devil meant to destroy us and to finish with us. The word of God says the enemy doesn't come to do anything but to kill, to steal, kill and destroy. And at that time, it was very, very close to him stealing my life. I remember, I don't know why I'm sharing this, Dad, but the Lord knows who he's talking to. But at that time, I remember I had these thoughts of seeing my funeral. And I even had dreams of seeing my funeral. I would even go out of the house and walk in the yard and say, the tent shall be built here for my funeral. And I would go and say, the people that will be preparing meals for the funerals will be preparing the meals here. And I would sit back and be relaxed and say, you know what? Yeah, everything is taken care of. And I would say, Ntate Habile would be preaching at my funeral. So everything is okay. So I called him and I said, hey, you know what? There is this thing that is troubling me. And you coming across as a person that will be preaching at my funeral. Knowing Ntate Habile, I want to believe that you guys know him. He just said to me, what's happening with you, Mashego? I said, no, I'm just sharing with you what's happening. He said, you are entertaining wrong guests in your midst. And I said, but I'm telling you my problem. Why are you not sympathizing with me? He said, I'm not going to sympathize with you. You are entertaining the spirit of death and you shall die. We'll bury you. Get rid of that guest. He's unwelcomed. You remember that, Dad? That was many, many, many years ago. And I'm standing here today. I'm a witness of what the Lord can do if you remain hooked and connected to Him. This morning, the Lord has placed in my heart a message to share with you. And the theme that I would like us to talk about this morning briefly, we've had a long discussion yesterday during the day, and in the evening we had a lovely time with the couples. Give the couples a big hand, Bazalwane. They were beautiful. The message that I would like us to talk about this morning is entitled, The Things We Learn Along the Way. The things we learn along the way. Let's get our scripture reading from the book of Mark chapter 6. We're starting to read from verse 32. We stop at verse 37. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary desert place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When people know that Jesus is in a place, they would run to that place. People don't just go to anywhere, they go to where Jesus is, because He draws people to Himself. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, He had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So He began teaching them many things. By this time it was late in the day, so His disciples came to Him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it is already late. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." Verse 36, I want us to go back to verse 36. "Send the people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." For me, that verse tends to be for me, it becomes sad that people can be with Jesus for a very long time, yet they don't learn anything from Him. People can be around Jesus, yet they don't know how He works. People can be with Jesus for many, many years, but when time comes for Jesus to manifest, they think it's about people's efforts. These guys have been with Jesus, and these people didn't have food. And they say to Jesus, "These guys don't have food. So Jesus, you know what? They are crowding our space. Send them away. Because we want to remain here with you. Because whatever food is here, it's for us. It's not for these guys. Just send them away." Okay. Hello?
Yeah.
Are you with me, Bazalwane?
Yeah.
Verse 36. He said, "Give them something to eat." You give them something to eat. Tell your neighbor, neighbor. Give somebody something to eat. Father, we thank You that You are providing for us to be able to be blessings to others. In the name of Jesus. As we continue, Heavenly Father, to go into Your word, continue to amplify it in our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Bazalwane, we are blessed to bless others. That's why Jesus says, you give them something to eat. Sometimes you might find that you might see yourself as not having sufficient or enough, but guess what? You've got something in Jesus. As we start this discussion this morning, I want to start off the discussion by saying, life is a journey that we all undertake. It starts when God releases us from eternity into time. I want to believe that as Christians, we have that understanding that we have existed long before we came into time. We were established in eternity. So by the time my mother conceives me, it's God appointed time for me to be released from eternity into time. So when God gives us or releases us, He releases us to live and not to try. That's why we say in him we live, in him we move, in him we find our being. Because we are not released from eternity into time for us to try living, but we are released for us to live. Different circumstances teach us different reactions to the exposures. When we come into time, yesterday when we spoke with the couples, we spoke about reality hitting or life happening. So when life starts happening, Ruti, we then get to be exposed and we then react to those different exposures. We then at an early age we learn as we proceed with our journey. As a child, you learn that there's a hot stove you'll burn. And you learn that at a very early age. As a child, you learn that if I defy my parents, I'll get a spanking on the bum. We learn along the way. So in Christian life as well, we need to be those kinds of people, like babies, to continue to learn. As we hit things, as we hit circumstances, as we hit rocks and stumbling blocks in our ways, we need to be not victims but students.
Yeah. All right.
Some of us tend to become victims of circumstances instead of becoming students, Mfundisi. Some things and circumstances turn our lives around. Job cursed the day he was born when trouble came. The question is, did the trouble come to Job because he did sin? Did trouble come to John because he has angered God? No, he hadn't angered God. Trouble came because Job was a good man. And I'm here to tell you this morning that you have to learn this as you move along in life, that you might come into trouble for the good things that you are doing.
All right.
For life to continue, we have to take the lesson and proceed. The best escort and the guider in the journey remains the one and only, and that's Jesus of Nazareth. The scripture that we read talks about Jesus going into a deserted place. And when he went there, the Bible tells us that people followed him into the desert. Tell the neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
They followed him into the desert. The question would be, why would people decide to follow somebody into a desert? In the time of technology that we live in, Muruti, there's no cell phone signal in a desert. In the time that we live in, there tends to be limited resources for food in a desert, unless it's imported into the desert. There is no communication in a desert. In a desert, if you go into a desert, you would know it's barren. There's isolation and there's desperation. But these people still followed Jesus into the desert. The question is, what is it, what testimony is there that these people knew something about Jesus? We read in the Bible that the people that followed him had already been exposed to him that calmed the storm in the sea. He is the same that they saw raising Lazarus from the dead. He gave them already sweet wine, the best wine, at the wedding of Cana. The woman that touched the hem of his garment was the witness of being healed. So these people knew exactly what they were following into the desert.
All right.
They didn't just follow blindly. They knew that the one that we are following into the desert is the one that has got answers to our problems. The question is, in your financial desert, can you follow Jesus? In your marital desert, can you follow Jesus? In your health desert, can you follow Jesus? When you are faced with a desert in your family, can you follow Jesus? What we learn this morning is that these people followed Jesus because they have learned that even in the desert, he is the provider that they could ask for. He was the best provider for their lives, for all their needs, even in the desert. He was the provider. When they were in the desert, as common sense would say, they then faced with reality. They then were faced with what you would call the nature call. And call, nature called Muruti. Nature said, "We are hungry." When they went there, I want to believe that some of them didn't even think about taking provision to go to the desert. Some of them might have thought that maybe we should take provision, but they then thought, no. The men that we are following into the desert, what is a plan? Because we know who he is, God himself. He is God in the nature of men. He is Jesus. They said in his presence, though we have challenges, those challenges will be taken care of. They believed that if God started our journey, God will complete our journey. They believed that if God said it, his word is true. If he said it, it is amen. The disciples say to Jesus, "Jesus, there is no food." I'm going to be offending to some people. Muruti, bear with me. I'm not going to look at you. But I'm going to be offending. As a pastor at church, I know that there are those Christians that don't get happy when other Christians come to the church. There are those people that tend to be offended by other people that come and join the church. There are those people that tend to feel, you know what, we've got enough professionals in this church now, we don't need an extra professional. Because when he comes, he'll take the limelight from me. So this space is just for me. And go and find another church. Don't come to MCC, because the MCC is here too. Hello, church. If you look into this verse 36, the disciples say, "Send them away." Babu Habil, they are coming into this church. We don't want them. Send them away. The disciples did not understand that God starts with the provision before the vision. God walks the path and completes it. Once he has completed the path, he goes back and say, "Now you can walk the path." Before he can set me up to say, "You can go on this journey," before he can even give me a vision, he has already made a provision. What are we talking about? He made the Garden of Eden.
Oh yes. Oh yes.
There was the Garden of Eden. Then when the Garden of Eden was there, he then placed man into the Garden of Eden. He made the provision before he brought the person. Ay man hamba nan. So these disciples did not have that understanding and that revelation.
All right.
God makes provision before the vision. Jesus says, "Feed them." And when you go down and read, you'll hear about the boy that had the fish and the bread. What are we talking about then? Some of the things that we learn along the way. We learn as we move along the way that in some cases, you would have the platform, but you might not have the means to meet the demands of the platform. Come with me. When Jesus said to his disciples, "Go and feed them. Jesus was basically saying to them, you've got the platform through which a miracle would happen.
All right.
You just need to go and identify the means that would enable the miracle to take place. The boy had the means. The disciples had the platform. The two needed to come to each other and merge for a miracle to happen.
Right.
Samuel had the hearing aid. Eli was old, he couldn't hear. Samuel could hear, but he couldn't make sense of what God was saying. You are sitting in the church, and God has given you the platform to do some things. You need to forge strategic partnerships with those that God have given the means to make the miracle happen. That's what we learn along the road. We learn along the way that you cannot make it alone. We learn along the road that alone I am just a loner. The word of God says two is better than one. Amen, Bazalwane. What do we learn along the road? Or along the way, as we walk on the path that God has called us to, we learn that we can call our Father in our times of need. Sometimes we feel lonely, sometimes we feel like we don't anywhere to run to, but we need to learn, Bazalwane, that along the way things will happen and our Father will be there in those times. Along the way, we need to learn that we need to wait until our change comes, not to rush for a quick solution. Sending away the people was the easy way out, but waiting for Jesus to give an instruction was the long way for the disciples. We need to wait until the change comes. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. In the waiting, we don't just wait. We learn along the way that as we wait for the Lord to come through for us, we need to renew our strength. As we wait for the Lord to come through for us, we need to encourage ourselves in the Lord. The word of God says when David was attacked by his own men, when the city was burnt down, David was discouraged. David's wives and kids were taken away, but David encouraged himself in the Lord. Siyadinga, we need to encourage ourselves as we wait upon the Lord. We encourage ourselves in the Lord. We don't wait for a pastor to preach to us. We don't wait to go to a home cell to be taught the way. We need to encourage ourselves. It is a time when what you have eaten needs to come through. It is a time when that which is in the head needs to descend to the heart to impact the body. Things we learn along the way. We learn along the way to trust the Lord no matter what the day will bring. Sometimes the day brings sour fruits. We need to learn that we should be trusting God. We need to rely upon God even when our friends do not show up. Sometimes friends don't show up, Mitsid. Sometimes friends just disappear. One thing that we learn as we move along the road, we need to learn that God is there. We need to stop crying for things we don't have, but to thank God for what we have. We need to thank Him for life and strength, which we don't pay for. We learn along the road that sin is the devil's detour to our destiny, and God pushes us back on track. As we are pushed out of grace, mercy catches us. We need to know that when you are pushed pushed out of grace, you know what? Mercy catches you.
Hallelujah.
We are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. Isaiah 40 verse 28 says, do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and there is no searching of his understanding. We need to learn along the road that the Lord gives strength to the weary and increases power to the weak. Every youth grow tired and weary, and the young men stumble and fall. But those that wait upon the Lord renew their strength.
Hallelujah.
Along the way, we need to learn that life is a school. That's something that we need to be learning. Isn't it we followed Jesus? Isn't it we're walking? He's gone to the desert. We need to learn as we follow him into those deserts. But you know what? As we walk and follow him, life is a school. It all happens because it's my destiny. Whatever happens around me, it happens because it's my destiny. What does destiny say? The king said, kill all the boys. Eternity and destiny said, keep the boys. Hello. We need to learn as we move along the way with Jesus. We need to learn that we cannot do it alone. We need destiny helpers. Bazalwane, we need destiny helpers. Your destiny shall never come to pass without those destiny helpers. When Herod wanted to kill Jesus, Joseph and Maria, or Mary, had to be the destiny helpers and carry Jesus away from the danger into Egypt. Jacob and Esau and their mother is a story again of destiny helpers. The mother had that the father was going to bless Esau. And the mother knew. She knew it. Mothers know, by the way.
Amen.
She knew that between Esau and Jacob, there is a bigger destiny with Jacob. And if the father was going to release the blessing on Esau, the blessing was going to be misplaced. Because the person of destiny, as far as God is concerned, it was Jacob. So the mother assisted to say, you know what? Let me ensure that the blessing falls to the right place. Destiny help us. We need, as we move along the road and on the way with Jesus, we need to learn that some people will leave for you to find yourself. Sometimes we tend to cry about people that have left us in our lives. Sometimes we tend to cry about people that have not completed one or two or three things in our lives. Those people, if they can leave, let them leave for you to learn something in life and for you to find yourself. Along the road, God allow some things to be lost for some things to be found. Along the road, he would allow some things to be lost for some things to be found. Ruth and Orpah had to lose their husbands. And the word of God says, Orpah, when the opportunity was given for her to go back to her folks, she grabbed the opportunity with both hands. But Ruth said, your God will be my God. Amen, Bazalwane. Your people shall be my people. And the rest is history. Because we hear of Boaz. The Boaz who was the grandfather. Hallelujah. Some things have to be lost for some things to be found. Along the road, we learn that we were predestined and there are battles that we should not be fighting. There are things that we tend to enter into battles on, and those things are not our own battles. We should stop fighting battles that do not belong to us. We should stop saying to people, let them go away. Because feeding those people that had followed Jesus, it was not the responsibility of the disciples. What they were supposed to be saying is, Lord, we've got more people. Show us the way how to feed them. Hello. Along the way, we learn that destiny is done in heaven. You walk in it, not towards it. Hello. I walk in my destiny. Sometimes I might take a long way, and it seems like this person has lost the path. And the destiny is that way, and I might be going in this particular direction. But guess what? I'm walking in my destiny. I'm not walking towards it. There are things that will happen along the path, which are things that God had designed for me to be equipped to be able to deal with the challenges that I'll be faced as I deliver on my destiny. Simple example, the challenges that Loretta and I had in our marriage. If we had not gone through those challenges, today we wouldn't be sympathizing with other families that are going through troubles. We have a better understanding today of people that are grappling with issues in their marriage, because we know what it means. We know what it means to be trapped in a particular habit. We know what it means to hurt each other. We know what it means for somebody to be sleeping and at the middle of the night starts crying. We know what it means. We know what it means for one to say, I'm hurting deeply. And when that person says, I'm hurting deeply, I don't think I'll be able to forgive this person. We cannot judge that person because we understand what it means. We didn't walk to it. We walked in it. At the time when it happened, it didn't seem as if it was adding any value to our lives. At the time that it happened, we thank God that He preserved us and not allowed the enemy to kill us in that time of preparation. Muruti, as Christians, as we move along and as we walk with Jesus, we need to have that understanding of incubation. That in my destiny, then there would be some periods of incubation which I need to sit there still and wait upon the Lord. Because it will seem as if nothing is happening. It will seem as if everything is falling apart. It will seem as if I'm not praying enough. It will seem as if I'm not walking with God. But it's a time of incubation.
Hallelujah.
And I need to learn that. I need to learn and be patient. Ooh, be patient with myself and with what God is doing in my life. Be patient in the time of incubation. If you don't know what incubation is talking about, go and talk to Hannah. And Hannah will tell you what it meant for incubation. When she was married, the Bible says Penina had children. She had one child, after another one, after another one. But she had to endure that incubation. She had to endure and wait upon the Lord. And at the appointed time, Samuel arrived. When Samuel arrived, the earth shook. When Samuel arrived, the history was rewritten. When Samuel arrived, things were never the same. When Samuel arrived, God spoke to Samuel. When Samuel arrived, Saul was anointed as the king. Because
Anna understood the incubation. If you don't learn along the way, you would destroy some things. You would destroy your destiny. You would destroy what God has in store for you because you don't understand what God is doing in your life.
Whew. Hallelujah.
As we walk along the road with Jesus, we need to learn to walk in the Perez anointing. Perez says, if you look at the name Perez, it says you received what you did not deserve. You go back and read that scripture. It talks about, what's the name of the lady? I've just forgotten the name of the lady, the mother to Perez. The Bible says she was married to the son of Judah. And that son died before she could conceive. And the second son was given to her. And he did what was despicable to God. God killed him. And the father-in-law sent her back home to say, go and stay with your parents until the youngest child has grown up. And the word of God says, when the son was grown up, Judah did not keep his word. And when Judah went to see his sheep, she heard that Judah was coming down the road. And she decided to be dressed up like a prostitute. And she sat at the gate. And when Judah, because Judah at that time, he was going through a desert because his wife, sexually he was going through a desert because his wife had died. So he then decided to entertain himself with this woman that he thought was a prostitute. And the woman then said to him, as a way of keeping your promise, because you said you're going to pay me using a goat, so you don't have the goat now, as a way of proving that you'll come back with a goat, give me your stuff. Judah gave the woman the stuff. And the word of God says, at the time when she lay with Judah, she got pregnant with twins. Now word went to Judah to say, your daughter-in-law is pregnant because of her prostitution activities. Because Mazalwane, Judah behaved like some of us who tend to be very, very quick to judge others. Hello? Am I talking to the right audience here? We tend to be very, very quick to judge. Okay? He then said, no. That woman, bring her here. She must be stoned to death. She did some prostitution activities. The word of God says, she then said, fine, you can stone me to death, but first before you stone me, let me show you, what do they call the evidence? Do they call it evidence? Exhibition. Of the exhibit. Of the man that made me pregnant. And she took it out, and it appeared that it was Judah's stuff. The one that had ordered her to die. And the word of God says, he then said, she is more holier than I am. She is better than I am. Let her live. The time for her to give birth, when it arrived, the word of God says, the first son put up his hand. I don't know how it happens for the child to bring the hand first. I mean, the doctors would tell me. He then said, Amandla. And when he said Amandla, the midwife tied a strip and Amandla withdrew. Then Perez came through.
All right.
As the first child. The Amandla came. The reason why they tied the strip on this child's arm was to identify him as the firstborn of the twins. But guess what? Perez then came out first before Amandla. And the name was given to him to say, your name will be Perez.
Because you got what you did not deserve. You ended up getting the blessing of being a firstborn. Yet you are not a firstborn. As we move along the way, we need to have an understanding that we are walking in the Perez anointing. We have things that you are not supposed to be getting. But by grace we have those things. We get those things. It is only by grace. Whew. As we walk along the road with Jesus, we need to learn that darkness and light need to separate. We need to learn that the waters that belong to the ground must stay on the ground, and the waters that belong to the heavens must be in the heavens. The two cannot be together. Darkness and light cannot be in the same room. We need to learn that as we walk with Jesus. As we walk with Jesus, we need to learn not to be part of confusion, as God has given us a spirit of sound mind. As we walk along the path, we need to learn to find our land and to work our land. Joshua chapter 13 verse 1. You will prosper in your land. As we walk along the path, we need to forge those strategic partnerships. Muruti, we need to have a revelation of what happened with Moses, Aaron, and Joshua. Amen. At the time when they were fighting. The word of God says, Moses was on the mountain, lifting up his hands. Aaron had to join him on the mountain to lift up the hands. Joshua was in the valley fighting the enemies of Israel. As we walk with Jesus, we need to learn that as a Joshua, I'm a Joshua, I'm not an Aaron.
Alright.
The problem that we tend to have as children of God, we are Aarons that are supposed to be lifting up the hands of the men of God. Once we are Aarons, up in the mountain there, I want to believe that there was silence. Down in the valley there with Joshua, there was a lot of noise.
All right, get it.
You can't be on the mountain with Moses and be noisy. You can't. How do you play your role up in the mountain being noisy? When you are Aaron, you just know that my job, Muruti, I'm a teacher, by the way. Kiahopela Muruti. Please take your seat here. Babengos, I'm going to join. Aaron and Huri, their job was to hold the old man's arms. For Israel to continue to conquer, for Israel to continue to prevail, they needed to hold these hands. It was not for them to strategize as to how the battle is going in the valley. That was not given to them. Their duty was to just hold the arms. I think that part of holding the arms was to check if he's still okay, he's not fading away, and maybe give him some water. And the Bible says, as long as the arms remained up, Israel prevailed.
Hallelujah.
When the hands were dropped, Israel was conquered. Now, as an Aaron, you need to learn that as an Aaron, you can't drop catches. Because when you drop catches, something happens in the church. You need to keep the arms up as an Aaron. That is your duty. As a Joshua down there, you need to know that my role in this church is to be giving instructions to say, this crew will go this way, this crew will go this way. You can't go and tell them, you must hold these hands this way, that way, and that way. You aren't. You are not equipped to be doing that.
Muruti. The Joshua was way. Because Joshua will say, no, this arm is not strategically positioned. That is the Joshua. Joshua says, no, it's not. It must be going that way because it's covering a bigger space. That's the strategy that says from Joshua's point of view. But from Aaron, he knows that the mandate and his brief was hold the arm upright. Whether it takes a lot of space or small space, your duty is to hold the arms straight up. Thank you, Muruti. The things we learn along the way. One of the things that we learn as we walk with Jesus, we learn and appreciate that God will do it just because they said it. Is the church with me? God will do it just because they said it. He is not responding to them or doing it for their favor, but he is doing it just to show that he's a sovereign God. When the children of Israel were fighting, I think it's the Amalekites that were saying, is their God not God of the hills only? Is he also God of the valleys? Their God is not the God of the valleys. Their God is the God of the hills. So let's go and attack them. The Bible says, God said, go and fight them, you will prevail. Just because they said, I'm not the God of the valley, I'll show them that I'm the God of the valley too.
Amen.
Some of the things God will do in your life just because they said it. Hello?
Amen.
They said you won't succeed. God will make you to succeed.
Amen.
Just because they said it.
Amen.
They said you won't have perfect health. God will do it.
Amen.
And you'll experience perfect health.
Amen.
Just because they said it. God will do it.
Right.
Along the way, we learn that if it's for us, no one can stand against us. Along the way, we learn that he's the God who says, I'm not counting your sins anymore. Come to me as you are, and I'll give you rest. Along the way, we continue to be affirmed that Jesus died, that you should be reconciled to God and not die, but have eternal life.
Amen.
His death was the ultimate expression of God's love for us. Along the way, we ultimately learned that we need Jesus more than he needs us. God doesn't need us, but we desperately need him. That we learn along the way. Thank you, Lord.